In this figure, we want to look at the nephron wall and how there are both pathways for and barriers to the processes of reabsorption and secretion. So at the top here, we have the nephron in cross-section. Here's the inside, the nephron lumen. This is the space through which our glomerular filtrate will be flowing and being modified through the processes of reabsorption and secretion. Reabsorption, of course, is the removal of a filtered substance, returning it to the bloodstream, the paratubular capillaries down here, whereas secretion is the addition of a substance not filtered to that nephron lumen, enhancing its excretion. The source of those secreted substances is also this paratubular capillary blood. Now, if we look at the wall of the nephron here, there are really two pathways across this barrier. There's a paracellular pathway and a transcellular pathway. The paracellular pathway is between the cells, and the barrier to movement across that pathway are these tight junction proteins shown here. Now, the tight junctions tend to limit the permeability across this paracellular pathway. However, in the early nephron, those tight junctions aren't really all that tight, and they allow significant paracellular movement of substances largely out of, but some into, the nephron. Now, the transcellular pathway over here is mediated by membrane proteins in the apical membrane over on this side and the basolateral membrane on this side. This would be for hydrophilic solutes that cannot pass through the lipid bilayers of our membranes. And these transport proteins can be primary active transport. They could be ATP mediated. They could be secondary active transport, forms of co and counter transport, but they could also be channels. And so we've got these pathways across the apical and the basolateral membrane for items being reabsorbed or secreted. Now, when something is reabsorbed, it is put into the interstitial space here. What makes it be taken up by the paratubular capillary blood, right? It's just the nephron simply puts it into this interstitial space. However, if you recall, the blood oncotic pressure in the paratubular capillaries, pi C, due to the presence of the plasma proteins that are trapped in here, will tend to pull water and small solutes inward. So anything that gets reabsorbed into this interstitial space will largely get pulled into the paratubular capillary bud and carried off into the systemic circulation. Now, it is also the source for items that are going to be secreted. Those items, these solutes, waste products, and toxins, have to diffuse outward down their concentration gradient. This puts them in this interstitial space and allows them to be transported into the nephron via these transport proteins that are moving waste and toxin solutes. The paratubular capillaries have fenestrations that make them very, very leaky, allowing for massive influx of the reabsorption products of the nephron. Note the nephron wall. The cells here in this section are cuboidal, and they also have microvilli. This is not true in all sections of the nephron. The nephron actually changes structure to meet needs at particular locations. In the early nephron, in the proximal convoluted tubule, we have these microvilli to dramatically enhance the surface area for the huge reabsorption that takes place there. Later in the nephron, we have cells that are much smaller, even squamous, and the transport mechanisms are going to be different. And so overall, the nephron wall forms both a barrier but provides passage to the items being reabsorbed and secreted, while our paratubular capillaries serve as the reservoir for things being reabsorbed, but also the source for items that are going to be secreted into the nephron.